our panelists for this session. We have Mr. Ambrose Briana from Uganda, Virak Cheng from Cambodia, and Satu Santala from Finland. Ambrose, I'm going to start with you. Now, in the session before this, we heard a lot about how youth programs really use very innovative and adaptive methods to approach vulnerable youth, but often in that conversation, disabled youths are left out. Now, in your work in Uganda, you've been working with the Ministry of Gender and Labour and Social Development to make sure your nationwide youth livelihood programme is specifically more disability friendly and is bringing in those disabled youth. Can you tell us about your innovative approaches? There's a microphone just there. If you pull that towards you.
Thank you so much. Before I can talk about the innovative approaches, I just want to find out whether we are so inclusive here. I just want to give you some small signs. If you argue with me, this is how you say yes. You hold your hand, put it down like that. Yes. Yes, can everybody sign? Yes, that's how we say yes in sign language. Yes, in Uganda, we have the youth livelihood program. This is a very big government program. And this program has been implemented so far, now 5 years. And around 250 young people generally have benefited. However, last year there was an evaluation of the program, which just indicated around between 6,000 to 7,000 youth with disabilities had benefited. But there came a big question. Why? Developed an inclusion game. And inclusion
it's really interesting to think about what we just saw in the video and what you're talking about, which is this idea that there are barriers both in attitude and in access, whether that be for physical disability, sensory disability, or it be intellectual disability. And as an advocate for disability myself, I find it's important to think about what we call the social model of disability, which says that it's not necessarily your impairment that disables you, but it's your environment. So it can be removing those environmental barriers that can help a disabled person into work or into accessing healthcare, education. So I think that's really important to keep in mind when we talk about disability here, that it's often, like the man said in the video, it can be a state of mind, and you remove certain barriers and that can really help to liberate people. So with that in mind, I want to talk to Virek about your work in Cambodia, where if you have a physical disability, you're going to face a lot of challenges because it's a rural environment. So it's a real particular challenge. Can you tell us about your work there and how you've helped people overcome some of those challenges with AgriLabs, your project?
Thank you, Sophie. Excellency, Moderator, ladies and gentlemen, today is my great honor that I have make a chance to be here to showcase our AgriLabs. That's what we are doing in Cambodia. And actually, our AgriLab is a part of our social innovation lab. We set up social innovation lab to create a solution, create an approach, knowledge, build a tool, equipment, building a pool of expertise to develop it for disability inclusion. We bring a lot of stakeholders together. We start to identify problems together. We start to build the solution together. And then start to test it. And if it works really well, we will scale it up or integrate it to other program initiatives. In fact, in Cambodia, agriculture is a central poverty reduction and hunger eradication. And it accounts about 35% of the GDPs. 79% of the 79% of total population live in the rural area, and they are, most of them rely on agriculture activities, mainly for food and incomes. And in Cambodia, it's also a home of persons with disabilities due to the landmine, road accident, and illness. About 48% of persons with disabilities live in the rural area, and sadly, we can see still most of persons with disabilities got difficulty access to agriculture activity that they are choosing. So they got difficulty due to there's no appropriate simple assistive device technology that make their farm suitable for them. And so often we also see that they were excluded from agriculture cooperative activity, which means that they lost opportunity to get supported from the government subsidy, from training, from capital access to market, that kind of thing. So AgriLab in Cambodia is a program that promotes, that empower farmers, including those with disabilities, to involve in identify the problem and solve the problem through the creative capacity building and collaborative design, co-design, I mean. So this is, and our AgriLab program in Cambodia also involves stakeholders. It's not just between life rural and farmers with disability, but there's other engineering technology stakeholders as well. Because we thought that the collaborative expert background would be beneficial when we design something. So mainly AgriLab program is aimed to empower a person with disability to develop their own solution. And also, of course, to develop the technology that can really help them. Yeah?
To show that's what we heard about earlier with Yeti, yeah. That nothing about us without us, enabling disabled people yeah. to design with you and collaborate yeah. with your support.
Exactly. It's not just designed for them, but designed with them. Mm. And we also take a chance to increase the sector knowledge as well on rural disability and showcase our AgriLab is the approach that can address, that can facilitate persons with disability involved in a discussion, seeing the problem identification and solution making. So we believe that through our AgriLab, it will lead to a real social inclusion and improve the livelihood of persons with disabilities. Because we can see the case that we are doing in Cambodia, people not just get assistive device at the end, but they enable them to fully participate in the societies. They change from just stay at home, they go to the field, get a water, get a firewood, do something.
The power of assistive technology cannot be underestimated. Small, very, very small changes can be made to integrate disabled people. Example that I heard from yesterday. In fact, if anybody has time to check out your stand outside in the atrium, I would encourage you to. There's examples of where Agni Labs have helped people with disabilities in the smallest way. For example, a woman who has a wheelchair, she wasn't able to leave her house. You helped us create a, how did you describe it?
A water cart. Because this is something that
so she could work. It's a simple thing.
This is something that will change. This is something that's not come from our assumptions, but it involves her in problem identification.
The process that you've used to design that solution is really collaborative and innovative, of course. So moving on to, I'm aware we haven't got a huge amount of time, and I do want to make space for everyone else to be able to ask some questions. So in Finland, you developed your approach to addressing the rights of persons with disabilities in the development, cooperation, and policy area. Can you tell us about your approach?
Yes, thank you, and great to be part of this important discussion. In Finland, we look at this in two ways. First of all, it is the right thing to do and our duty as a country in our development policy to take into consideration the rights and status of people with disabilities. And it's also good development. So we have to do it, we think, and it's also an intelligent thing to do. So first of all, so on the right thing to do, we apply a human rights-based approach to all of our development policy. So we look at the human rights frameworks that we subscribe to, and for example, the Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities, and we apply that to our work. And then also, we take very seriously the Agenda 2030, where it does say on many of the targets or of the goals that that it is about all and everyone, and including everyone, and leaving no one behind. But then, on good development, we know that in many countries this is a significant group of people that we're talking about. So it's not a marginal little issue; it's often quite a big issue. And if we ignore addressing it, we're never going to achieve the sustainable development goals. So we think it's better to address it. We also know that that poverty, food insecurity, and disability are closely interlinked. So we get to many of the big problems by addressing it. And we know that people with disabilities are overrepresented among the poorest and people in most vulnerable situations. And in addition, there's also an economic cost to exclusion. We need more research into this, but we already do know that the countries' GDPs would be higher if everyone can work according to their full potential in their communities and participate. In Finland, we apply a dual strategy, so we both have targeted support to activities that promote people with disabilities, and then we also apply it as a cross-cutting target to everything we do. So within non-discrimination work, we ensure that whatever we support is always disability inclusive. We've been greatly benefiting in Finland from our disability movement. They've been pushing us, government, quite hard at being better at disability. And we've learned over the years. We still have, of course, things to learn, but they are great. They're very active. They also deliver a big part of our disability aid. So 70% of our funding to disability in development goes through Finnish DPOs, disabled people's organizations. We also are quite active in trying to push our international partners, including IFA, fact, but also humanitarian organizations and other other international organizations to do more, to be more systematic. And we do this together with other partners. We also are the largest contributor to the UN partnership to promote rights of persons with disabilities. So this is a collaboration among organizations across the board. We've also done some interesting work on disability inclusive education in Ethiopia, disability inclusive water and sanitation in some countries and so on. So a variety of different activities.
Brilliant. I want to pick up on something you said, just it seems common sense, but for a country to consider that its overall national GDP would raise if everyone is able to work to their full potential, it seems common sense to me, but that is what we're here to try and think about, is getting everybody to be able to fulfill their full potential. One thing we are very aware of those of us that live and work in this space, is that the figures aren't really there, the data isn't really there. We have an estimated figure that it's 15% of the global population have a disability, but of course we don't really know. There's two problems. One is that the questions aren't being asked, and the other is that often you might find, even when you're within your own organisations, people have a disability they may not want to disclose, because often there's a stigma attached, there can be discrimination, there's a lot of fear around it. So there are barriers to also understanding the full scale of the problem. So one area that one area we're going to talk to Ambrose about. So in Uganda, 12.4% of your population recognise themselves as having a disability, and you created a campaign called Make That 12.4% Work. Could you tell us more about the campaign?
Thank you. 12.4% work campaign. Anyway, 12.4%, what does it mean? It represents the total number of people with disabilities in the country. And this campaign is focusing into areas around inclusive life forms and inclusive employment. And in this campaign, what we try to do is to ensure that mainstream organizations, government departments, programs are inclusive. And we do this through capacity building. For example, officials of the government, officials from different agencies, organizations. And we have different approaches through which we can do, and can do this through an inclusion lab. So, but also for each of us, sustainability, we have to use the government structures. Like in our case, we have local government structures. And we came up with a steering committee under 12.4%, and it's being chaired by officials from the ministry. And of course, have it in the secretary of that committee. So it brings a level of ownership. And of course, the stakeholders are part of this kind of committee. For us, we just go there to participate in the meeting, but we feel the government should own these systems. So for us, we feel, and the government also can feel they have a responsibility to make sure the programs benefit people with disabilities. The second area, we have the structure of membership. We, under this campaign for making 12.4%, we always ask agencies to express interest in joining the campaign, and it is a proof of commitment. They will sign a proof of commitment, the one page, to show that yes, we are so committed. And of course, it means that their organization had accepted to ensure that at least their program is disability inclusive, and hence they adhere to the campaign. For example, since 2 years ago, we started with 12 members, but as we speak now, we have around 124 members who have subscribed. We want to use something like a snowball kind of arrangement. After this kind of interaction, the organization becomes inclusive. They are always attract other members to come and join this kind of campaign. Now, the third area I want to talk about is we always use what we call disability in of your those experiences to share them with other agencies. And we realize that people have been crying and presenting problems, they are facing problems. We value talking about the solutions to such problems. Therefore, our inclusion academy prepares the young people with disabilities to understand how they solve such problems. And the inclusion facilitator, disability facilitators, they are based in other localities for sustainability purposes. And also, we also have what we call policy influence aspect, where we always engage with a number of ministries to ensure that when they have policies, they are amend to be in conformity with international instruments so that people in service can benefit. Thank you.
Thank you, Andres. I think it's really important to bear that in mind, is to listen to the stories that the advocates, the disabled people themselves and their lived experience. So thank you for sharing that. Coming back to assistive technology, I think it's really interesting to bring that into the context here, that in rural environments, assistive tech for people with physical disabilities or any kind of disability can make all the difference, as I spoke to earlier. Can you share with us just briefly, so we've got more time to open up to questions, but what are the key learnings that you've found from AgriLabs when it comes to integrating disability and engineering and innovation, all of that wonderful hybrid?
Yeah, thank you very much. Regarding with the key learning that we are getting from our AgriLab in Cambodia, because since the work we are doing it more on involve persons with disability in a different stage, start from the capacity building, problem identification, and build the solution. So involve and require a lot of facilitation here. And we build a local facilitators on how to facilitate AgriLab build capacity, how to facilitate AgriLab program. And the key thing is the facilitator have to be trained on disability inclusion, because they will take the journey to work with persons with disability for several months, see the problem identification and try to engage and use the information to build the technologies. So the key learning from that regard, I would divide it into two parts. One, let's talk about how the technology is developed. Because at the point before the technology developed, it required a lot of facilitation. So one important thing that we have to take into account is try to include our person in a discussion, just to make sure that we are not leaving behind people behind. Because people, we can divide them into kind of different groups. So the facilitator has to bear in mind that have to involve them in a discussion, try to get practical information from them. Make sure that there's no one stay far away from the discussion. And the second point is about people center, not technology center. So make sure that we develop something, develop technology, develop tool equipment that are really useful for people, using the information. Do not carry developing something that is without any discussion or consultation with person ask the owner the issue, because sometimes it might not be. And so social empowerment is very important, like I mentioned. It's not just something that we design for them, but we design with them, so it requires time and a commitment. Because we're going to leave the technology at the end of the day with the community, so people have to know that even if we leave the community. Technology comes on board. We have the technology. So the thing that we have to consider, I have a few points from our learning in AgriLab. So we have to think of shoebox, like the technology had to be practical, and reflect to the issue that has been addressed by the person. They can use it, accessible, they can use it easy, and affordable. It can be done by the communities, they can use the local material, and they can use something around their house. And all the material can be afforded, can be bought by the community. This is something that we should take into account as well. Sustainable. It can be managed by people, actually. We leave the technology, we leave the assistive device with them. So they have to know that they can manage it, they can use it. There is a potential to scale up, so which means that there's a need in there are the people in the community, they need that as well. So it's going to be a very important that, a thing that we have to take into account. An important thing about technology, it has to be safe. People can use it very safely. So yeah, yeah. This is my
Thank
point
you.
From me.
Thank you. Really, really so significant. Just small things. And I think just to keep going back to that point, that the events you want to for disabled people keep repeating this, there's a real need to work with us. On that note, one of the reasons we're here having this panel on the main stage, not as a sort of side event, really important. IFAN is calling to us to and asking questions of us about how to move forward and bring disability into the conversation. Ayeti touched on this earlier in her keynote speech. We've talked a lot about women here, we've talked a lot about various other groups that cannot be left behind, but disability is often left out of that. So finally, Tati, I'd like to go back to you to ask you, what would you like IFAD to do? What would you encourage them to do? And yeah, without putting too much pressure, what are your asks?
You do need to put some pressure, I think.
I mean, on all of us. Put all the pressure on.
Yeah, no, but on all of us. I think the first opportunity that we have is really the replenishment discussions that are just starting this week. And I think this is a good opportunity to really look at what is a good way of including disability in IFAD's work. We have to remember that disability inclusion does not happen by chance. It's sort of a deliberate action that has to be taken. It requires corporate level commitment, knowledge and skills, dedicated resources, and accountability towards these objectives. And the replenishment is a good place to start looking at this. I have four little recommendations. First of all, it's important to take this slogan that's been said several times already, nothing about us without us, very seriously. So I highly recommend that IFAD continues to build partnerships, organizations with persons with disabilities, including organizations representing women with disabilities, and to arrange consultations and spaces for discussion, and to use experts with disabilities. These are important things to do. Secondly, I recommend an approach where you both mainstream and then have some targeted support, because that's a most effective combination for results. Thirdly, don't think of disability as yet another thing that has to be addressed in isolation. But it's important to look at multiple and intersecting reasons for discrimination. So when you talk about women or look at gender issues, also take into consideration disability, the same and so on. Because the truth is that often people are facing several of these, everyone is a combination of different elements. And then finally, it was already mentioned, but I'll repeat it, systematic collection and use of disability disaggregated data is really important. We just do not know enough. We don't know enough globally, and we don't know enough locally, and really this is important for IFAD to move forward on. So these are some of the thoughts that I wanted to raise.
Thank you. I think the figures we have in the UK, which I think are the current and right figures, is 1 in 5 people in the world have a disability. So just bear that in mind. 1 in 5, if that can kind of put that into the room, how many people that might be with an undisclosed hidden disability, who knows. So I'd like to open it up now and invite your reactions and questions to the panel. And if you do have something to say, please can you let us know who you might want to address it to, if not to everybody, and let us know where you're from as well.
About the data, 1 in 5. I think if we have the available data, then it might be.
talking about the replenishment, this is a good time actually to talk about, you know, how IFA can take further initiative in this area. So, you know, you are talking about the disability, but I actually, that is, you know, the my colleagues that, you know, we can see the intellectual disability also, you know, and the autism. Now, you know, that the country is facing, you know, this is the biggest problem, especially the countries who are economically vulnerable. And how these people can be mainstream, or they can be, you know, included in the value chain. Because in some of the countries, as I mentioned, that they are economically vulnerable. So these people are actually economically very backward, you know, and the welfare structure of the government is not well designed. You know, so these people, their livelihood is always challenging. You know? So if to left, you know, she mentioned some interesting points, you know, that so we need to start, you know, with the baseline data and country-wise data. You know, this we can start. Not globally, but at least the, you know, the countries which doesn't have any good structure, that the welfare system is not, you know, well structured. Even it's, you know, in many of the countries. So this data actually can help government to design and to work with IFA. So and we can combat the challenges in future. Actually, we can start from this point. This is my actual opinion. Thank you very much.
Thank you. It's a very valid point. And so the data to inform moving forward and trying to make sure that you get the right data, but also ask when census is being done, when information is being gathered, make sure to think about integrating those questions around impairment, around disability, to try and get a better picture. Thank you. From Canada. Sorry, I didn't see where you were from. I didn't say Bangladesh. Sorry. Thank you. Hello.
Thanks very much for this super interesting panel. This morning we were talking about how IFA can engage more effectively in countries in post-conflict or in conflict situations, and wondering if you can have us comment on the special challenges of working in being inclusive of disabled people in such situations, including disabilities caused by the conflict, including mental health issues.
Do you want to address that to anyone in particular?
Yes. In Uganda, for example, we are facing the same challenge like in northern Uganda, where there are a lot of refugees coming from South Sudan, and there's a lot of influx entering Uganda. I think over 1 million refugees have come to Uganda in the West Nile region. And some of them say they have a disability. But now, that's what my colleague has said, data is not disaggregated. Why? They always use SPA or PSN, sorry. The people who work in conflict using what PSN, persons with special persons in need, yeah? Something like that terminology. It's just general, whether you are elderly, whether you are a woman, they always PSN, persons with special needs, they categorize. So they without understanding what kind of special need that this person has. Is it this part of the visual disability, or hair impairment, or elderly? They just group them, PSA. And
to a good point that the intersectionality between each different type of uniques. So you've got, you know, you've got women with disabilities, with women, and they have got their own unique discrimination, and then you've got the complication on top of that of them having a physical disability, and so this one big group of disabled people is not homogenous. We're not. It's so unique. So breaking it down and really understanding the unique needs is key at the very very early stages to be able to address those needs. Do you have anything further you would like to?
Yeah, add? I think I would add a little bit regarding to the data as well. For example, like recently in Cambodia we have integrated disability data to our census, so which hopefully we can get. It's not coming out yet, but it's really good to look at existing mechanisms, because we all have all the questionnaires that we collect every 5 years in our country, and disability data and so on the group have been integrated. So it will be very useful that information will come out by a different type, category of a person with disability. And this is one thing about the data, I think. And another thing, if you look at the national mechanism, and at the moment we can see we have quite a lot of good stuff at the top, like strategy, policy, that kind of thing. And yeah, we have data, yeah? We have the strategy, we have the guideline, and how we ensure that those will be work and we benefit to people in the ground. Like the thing that we are doing in one province, like some of the government, they need more understanding on how to support persons with disability in their community. Even they have data, they have the policy, but they just realize that they have some role to responsible.
I think it comes back to what we keep saying is listening and asking the right questions. The people out there that are living the experience can speak to these issues and can inform so that people can really make the right choices around how best to help. Oh, hello. It's Senegal.
De résilience qui va au-delà de la moyenne. Donc, on est. Et c'est pour cela que vraiment, je tenais à prendre la parole pour saluer cette vidéo. Et au-delà de cela, les efforts que le FIDA apporte dans le travail d'intégration et de développement du monde rural. Je pense que c'est connu de tous, le FIDA apporte appréciable à tous les pays en développement, le monde rural, et le Sénégal n'est pas en reste. Depuis des décennies, peut-être dès le début du FIDA, certaines institutions interviennent dans notre pays. Moi-même, je suis d'une région où le FIDA a fait des efforts extraordinaires qui sont restés jusqu'à présent, qui servent à tous. Donc, nous saluons l'action du FIDA. Nous saluons l'action du FIDA qui vient d'être relancée dans le cadre du COSOP, le programme stratégique des opportunités des pays du Sénégal qui a été validé en 2019 et qui permettra au FIDA de continuer à financer des projets tels que le Badaïen, le Papa. Et vraiment, pour tout cela, nous tenons à prendre la parole et à compléter ce que nos panélistes viennent de dire sur la question. Je vous remercie.
When given those opportunities, can really excel. You know, they really can excel. We've done a study in the UK that found that people that with disabilities when put into the workforce had actually not only benefited themselves, but the wider community, the whole entire organisations have benefited from their resilience, as you say, creativity, the ways in which disabled people have to adapt to the world and bring that into work, and it can benefit everybody. So thank you so much. Do you have anything you want to add before we then go to Mexico? Do you guys want to add anything to that?
Thank you, ma'am. I think I don't get full. I just want to share something about that point, so especially about the inclusion of persons with disabilities. So since we are here, I think we have many years experience working with persons with disability in the rural area, and we can see that there's a lot of potential that persons with disability can be included and they can do a lot of for themselves. So we just have to agree that there is opportunity and potential to include them. So all we need to see it, we have to reflect on the role of the stakeholder, how can they support the journeys. So like we do in other programs, in our Women with Disability program, we bring a lot of women from the remote area and just stay at home. Some of them stay 60 years at home and they're going out. So just the moment that they are going out, come to meet each other together, we just realize that, of course, this is the world. And all we do is just to provide them the capacity building, provide them the opportunity and resources for them to realize their potential. So, yeah, and this is really works from our field experience.
Mexico, if you had a question.
that area, maybe, for example, like I'm from Cambodia, maybe farther to look at what actually the existing mechanism that already exists. For example, we have quite a, like we have a quota system, we have the National Disability Search, we have a disability law, and then how we can synergies between the IFRPs and the MIS and try to reinforce all the policy to be beneficial to all the people. So that policy enforcement, that's
yeah, so enforce policy that already exists.
Thank you. So just summary points. Thank you, Mexico. I think I just wanted to make two quick points with the interventions from Bangladesh. We understand that there are underrepresented groups with disabilities, even within the disability group, and you mentioned psychosocial and intellectual disabilities. Yes, that's why I was pointing out to all limits, to all men, especially interventions are needed to address that. On the point from Canada, I really want to highlight that this is what we want to see. Disability in a conflict setting is another setting, and I'm sure those from Afghanistan, Somalia, and the rest of the countries could have points at the time, I would say so. But yes, that's important, and the disability inclusion context is different when it comes to humanitarian settings, and I'm sure for the upcoming sessions with ACFA, we're going to see this more and more included with disability inclusion in the youth, because we have youth with disabilities, and the human transiting is another picture, of course, that the human has newly acquired disabilities. One last point from Mexico that I would like to make is that, yes, you're right, the Convention on Rights of Persons with Disabilities is key, and Mexico is one of the champions leading, of course. Now we have 181 champions at the youth, and so all the member states nearly have a fight, but the point mainly is, what can IFA do? Because we know IFA is IFI, International Financing Institution. So one thing is aiming for an inclusive financing and trying to make sure that the towards replenishment leave no one behind. With that, I think it's possible to first know where they are, where the persons with disabilities are. And I think the important step to start is data collection, of course. But the second thing is, of course, IFA has its own aims that they do rural transformation and things like that. For example, this morning I heard that IFAD has granted or allocated $900 million in Ethiopia. Ethiopia has 17.6 million persons with disabilities. Making sure that the 17.6 persons are benefiting from this is key, and having an indicator to measure that those finances coming out of the recipient countries from IFAD are used in an inclusive manner is something that they can do. And I think we can learn a lot from institutions like World Bank, for example, with their recent IDA replenishment. It was clear that disability inclusion was included. So I think there is a room to learn. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. What matters most is that we, as especially member states, need to make sure that leave no one behind is beyond a slogan and its experience lived. So for IFAD, I would say that they start from the data and they build on mechanisms to monitor that finance is used in an inclusive way. And last but not least, there is a need to target disability-specific programs as the ones we saw in Senegal, because there is a need to narrow down the exclusion. There is already a very, very deep-rooted exclusion. Last but not least, I just want to use this moment, Sophie, to invite IFI to join the Global Action on Disability that I mentioned, because where donors are coming together to discuss what they can do, and this is fantastic, UK as co-chairing as well as NORAD. So this is fantastic that we have a space to learn from each other. So don't panic, it's not me. Thank you.
I'm so sorry we're going to have to wrap that up. I think on behalf of all of us, let's say if you do have any further questions, I'm sure all of the panelists will be open to carrying us on after the session wraps up. But for now, thank you, panelists. I would like to now welcome onto the stage the world's first deaf artist to ever hold a record label. Simon is from Finland, and he will be here to talk to you about his life and his work, and then we'll be giving a quick performance. But luckily, I had a different situation, and I've been able to study throughout my schooling, throughout my life. And me being able to study with my own mother tongue gave me the opportunity to study all the way to university. And it gave me the opportunity to graduate as a Master of Education. Since I was a little kid, I always dreamt of being an artist. And I decided to make that dream come true around 20 years ago. And it hasn't been easy. It's been super hard, all the prejudice, all the attitudes that I had to face. But luckily, I'm a really stubborn guy, and I fought for my dream. And I knew that there is something unique, there is something very innovative in my work. Actually, I've been representing Finland in the Eurovision Song Contest or in the Finnish competition, and I placed second there. And after that, I became the first deaf artist ever to make an international record deal. So far, I've been performing in over 50 countries. And also, when I contacted the Finnish Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and proposed a cooperation with them. They saw the importance and the value of my work and my vision, and they were willing to work with me. And then I got to travel even more. I've been lecturing and giving speeches and performances like this today. For the future, I had a backup plan as well. I can't make my living as a musician throughout the whole life, so I decided to establish a company. So I have an interpreting agency. I have 25 interpreters working for me at the moment. And you can never underestimate the importance of interpreting, which you should never. Because without interpreters, none of you would understand me today. Through interpreting, I get my voice heard. So I want to thank Saria for her precious work and all the spoken language interpreters up in their booths. Thank you. I really respect your work.
mobile application that provides the interpreting in several languages. You should look it up on our website. It's called Shadla. So everything that I've gained so far and that I've been able to do so far is thanks to Finnish society who has led me to be this innovative, and they have given me the opportunity to chase my dreams. They have given me the opportunity to work for me and to work for other minorities. Before I give the floor to Adam, there is one thing that I want to share with you. It's kind of a philosophy that I live my life with. When you give another person the opportunity, you're giving yourself an opportunity. And you, all of you sitting here today, you have the opportunity today to do something for your home countries. Do it. Don't wait. Thank you.
My name is Adam Tensta. It's an honor to be here to perform in front of you. Before that, I would just like to further some words on our recent collaboration, or not so recent actually, been going on for a couple of years. And we noticed that our mission is supposed to be about bridging the gap between hearing and non-hearing within culture, specifically within music. And this is something that hearing people in particular never seem to think about, that there's actually an audience for music within the deaf community. So there's obviously massive potential, and this is collaboration, and we hope you like it. Thank you. So we need your help. Goes like this.
Sorry, if you'd like to, thank you, yeah. I can't see where you're from, sorry, Honduras.
tema de tener una ley obviamente puede mejorar el trabajo que se hace hacia tener más atención a los discapacitados para meterlos en el trabajo laboral. Esta ley en Honduras obliga a las empresas a tener un 4% de empleados, ya sea en la zona rural o urbana, de personas discapacitadas. El cumplimiento de la ley a veces es difícil, pero mi pregunta va ahorita así, en la experiencia de ustedes, ¿sienten que estas leyes pueden apoyar el empleo de las personas discapacitadas? Gracias.
It's a law enforcement and it also awareness and monitoring. And we also see employment, it's quite a complicated topic. So we also need to look at the chain of employment because sometimes it also involved with the vocational training that we have to pay attention on that. But the fact in Cambodia, like, there's a demand to employ persons with disabilities. Like, some persons with disabilities cannot qualify to get jobs. And like Ambro mentioned, it's really good. It's not just about charity, it's about business case. So we have to make sure that people with disability is ready to be there and the company is ready to accept person with disability. So it will a long-term sustainability employment for and benefit for all.
Absolutely. We also see in the UK the need to educate the disabled people themselves on their rights. So the laws might be there. This might be someone trying to enforce that. But if you don't know yourself that you have a right to be there, then you can often feel that you're pushed out without fighting for yourself. So it's a raising awareness on every level. I think we're squeezing one more.
looks differently. What do you call in the areas face challenges in food security? Insecurity and poverty. But this is more compounded when an individual has a disability. Yet in the SDGs, we are committed to leaving no one behind. We cannot afford to leave people with disability behind in issues of food security and rural development. In Uganda, as Mr. Murangira said, we've tried to mainstream issues of people with disability into government policies and legislation. This has assured schools, very special schools for the handicapped, healthcare, among others. And government has taken deliberate action to have special representation in parliament and local councils that for the disabled to articulate their issues. We are now trying to ensure they are able to access finance to undertake gainful economic activities. We want to ensure that they are involved in all available gainful economic activities, including agriculture. As we know that this is not easy in rural areas, but we must undertake it. We definitely will work with the IFAD, and we'd like to see IFAD, besides what they're already doing with the disabled, to see components of their work included in the project designs, especially country designs, so that the handicap at whatever category women, youth, and men should be involved in the activities that the others are doing. And if I could also consider investing in assistive technologies to enable people with disability to engage in agriculture. And those would be done according to the need of the disabled person. I know that the disabled people are very industrious. I was involved in teaching the blind, and I know that they are not really blind. They can see, and they are hardworking people. And you can see that some younger have made it through school in Uganda because of this deliberate policy. Yes, we still have the stigma. Yes, people still discriminate, but more parents are taking their children to school. Attitude in Uganda is changing towards the disabled because government has made a deliberate effort to make sure they are represented at every level of governance, from the local government to the national level. The disabled people are represented, and this has increased respect for them. This has increased also confidence in employing the handicapped. We even see them during the news reading, you know, the news is interpreted for them so that they are not left behind. So something is happening in our country, but of course a lot more needs to be done. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I think it's a real lesson to leave the session on that. Not only can we learn from the disabled, we can learn from each other and practices that are happening in other countries all around the world. So I'm going to wrap it up there. But before I go, I just want to remind everyone that IFAD is currently offering a grant of up to $3 million to rural transformation projects that are disability inclusive. So please go to the website to find out more information on that. And as we heard earlier, the consultation on the 12th replenishment of IFAD's resources begins this month. And with exactly 10 years left to achieve the SDGs, this IFAD 12 consultation has the potential to be a pivotal moment for the international community to mobilize the political and financial support required to deliver on those goals. So I hope this panel has encouraged and inspired you all to consider how important it is to change IFAD's financial architecture to include disabled people and make sure that nobody is left behind. Thank you very much.